Thousands of pathogens circulate amongst humans globally, and sometimes there is a lot of time that passes between two outbreaks. If we take Ebola, for example, there was a long stretch of about 17 years between 77 and 1994 when there were no deaths from Ebola. I mean, where did Ebola go and where is it when it's seemingly nowhere? My name is Eugene Bangwen, and I am a biomedical scientist. 2 years ago, I started working with ITN as a scientific fellow, and a lot of what I do is outbreaks research, and today we are going to be talking about disease reservoir. Many pathogens, viruses especially, would not live out of another living organism. And so where they live and multiply and are able to survive, especially long-term, is what you call a reservoir. Humans serve as reservoirs for a very wide range of pathogens. This could be sexually transmitted infections, for example, or say respiratory pathogens, or basically diseases that do not need a sort of animal intermediary. Animals are known to host a variety of emerging pathogens. Many epidemics and pandemics are a result of what we describe as spillover events that would basically mean a pathogen has jumped from an animal into human. And usually this is followed by a series of human-to-human transmission events. If you would take the case of HIV, which started as a result of a spillover event and now has remained within the human population. So I think it is really very important to study reservoirs as a means to control infectious diseases. In certain instances, there could be more than one host for a particular organism. And imagine that you do not have a vaccine that would control this pathogen in the human population. But you have a vaccine that might work very well in an animal population, then you want to try to identify as many reservoirs for this animal as possible in order to vaccinate and control this this disease. Jackals, for example, which were suspected as a reservoir for rabies in Zimbabwe in the 90s, and it raised the whole debate whether this should also be vaccinated as a way to control rabies, equally as dogs. You have what we call the viral load, which would be the quantity of a virus that is in the living organism. And sometimes, because it's so low, it gets difficult to be picked up by diagnostic tests. In addition to, say, occurring in very low viral loads in its reservoir, sometimes the prevalence of a particular organism is really very low, even within the animal subpopulation. So even when you successfully identify the host, it may still be very difficult to identify one particular organism that is infected by this pathogen. Taking Ebola as an example, fruit bats are a presumptive reservoir for Ebola. But indeed, to be able to catch the bats, identify or collect biological samples, set some, let's say, geolocation trackers, and then release these bats into the environment, this is indeed a very difficult process. It would be best to study the reservoir during an ongoing outbreak. This is because you imagine that if this were a result of a spillover event from an animal source, then probably this is still looming in the animal population. But then, unfortunately, during outbreaks, the focus is on treating or controlling, or the focus is on the human population. And so this, unfortunately, which is viral ecological research, to decide. The problem with Zile is the fact that the prevalence probably drops, the viral load within the hosts will probably also drop, and maybe this is a disease that occurs seasonally, and so researchers are going to run out of time. In recent years, there is a lot of talk about globalization and deforestation, and all this is contributing to climate change. And what happens is now there is a lot of contact between the animal to the human population, and this in several ways exposes us to a lot of these emerging pathogens. So if we can conserve the environment, then we can better protect our health. If you want to know more about reservoirs, then listen to our podcast.